instruments are fine. And instruments, do you know where to...
We will take with us.
Okay.
Good. Wonderful. Now it's so perfect. So
Okay. So I'm glad you're happy with it. Are you doing the talking before or
no,
you come after?
We are not. Just...
You just come on, just
play.
For that.
And do you like the balance and the relationship?
Yeah, I think it sounds good. I'll make small adjustments as the performance once
sure.
We've got people in.
No,
I think it sounds nice.
When I speak solo,
so I'll give you a little bit more for that point.
Mm-hmm.
I don't really know, because I think we need to wait until the speakers get in the room.
Yeah.
And then set them up. So we've got the mic set there. I mean, I suppose what we can do. Let's get them. If you can put 3 and 4, I'll do this as 1 and 2.
3 and 4.
In fact, 1, 2. So make that 1, 4. So we're going 1, 2, 3, 4.
Quand tes cheveux s'étalent comme un soleil d'été et que ton oreiller ressemble au champ de blé, quand l'ombre et la des forêts et des îles au trésor. Que je t'aime, que je t'aime, que je t'aime. Que je t'aime, que je t'aime, que je t'aime. Quand ta bouche se fait douce, quand ton corps se fait dur, quand le ciel dans tes yeux d'un seul coup n'est plus pur, quand tes mains voudraient bien, quand tes doigts n'osent pas, quand ta pudeur dit non d'une toute petite voix.
On n'a pas besoin de chercher si loin. Non, on n'a pas besoin de chercher si loin. On trouve ce qu'on veut à côté de chez soi. Des sourires, des aveux et des langues de bois qui t'alanguissent, te pourrissent et font de ton cerveau un joli petit brouillon.
l'amour de son prochain. On n'en pense que du bien, mais on a tous notre territoire. Et là, tu vois, on veut pas d'histoire. On peut toujours en discuter entre tribus. La vie n'est pas un grand mystère, c'est dans l'amour de son prochain qu'il faut envisager demain. Non, 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 il faut pas se laisser faire. La vie n'est pas un grand mystère, c'est dans l'amour de son prochain qu'il faut envisager.
For me to deal with this PowerPoint.
Oh, yeah, I didn't.
No, I know, I just those stuff.
I
think it's a really good, smooth.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. And welcome to this very special afternoon. I'm Judy Trotter, Head of Education here at JW3. It's always a huge privilege and pleasure to be working with the Lithuanian Embassy. And my thanks to Ulla and to Gitana for working so arduously over the last few months. Of course, the world changed for us on 7th of October, and the last few weeks have been incredibly difficult. With glimmers of hope this weekend, which we hope will continue. I think it's around 4 years that JW3's been working with Litvak Days in London, but the event has been going for 12 years, so we're delighted to now be part of this very special annual occasion. I think the volume of conversation is what is very important to all of us, but it's always been our starting point at JW3. And the last few weeks have shown how very important it is for us to be together, to connect with each other, both in the room and to those of you on Zoom, which is quite a lot. So we're delighted to be able to do both. So we're celebrating today and dedicating this occasion to the 700th anniversary of the founding of Vilnius. You'll be hearing a lot more. We have an amazing program for you. But it's now my honor to invite Lina to the microphone, the Charge d'Affaires of Lithuania to the UK. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good evening, dear excellencies, honorable guests and friends. It is my great honor to welcome you today to the 12th Litvak Days in London, which is an event traditionally organized by the Embassy of Lithuania in London in cooperation with our partners. Every year, we invite our guests to explore a specific aspect of Litvak identity and heritage. And this year, the event will be dedicated to a 700-year anniversary of Lithuania's capital, Vilnius. Vilnius has been a cradle of Jewish community and Jewish tradition for ages. And as a multicultural city, Vilnius owes a lot of it to the Jewish community and Litva community for uplifting and reshaping the image of city through decades and centuries. The Jewish tradition in Vilnius has started with a story of Grand Duke Gediminas and his letters in 1323. And we are very glad to see that those cultural ties that started back then continues today as we speak. Today, we will have an opportunity to become a part of inspiring discussion by prominent representatives of Lithuanian and British academia. And I hope this discussion today will awaken historic multicultural memory of city of Vilnius, and also will reflect on the significance of the Vilna Jewish cultural identity and legacy. Today's program also foresees a traditional Litvak music concert by Lithuanian performers Marija Krupaves and Borisas Kirsneris. I hope this program will give you an opportunity to experience a trip to a historic homeland of Litvak community. I hope it will also be a nice opportunity to enrich your knowledge and understanding of the Litvak tradition and heritage, and also an opportunity to share your own memories and inspiring personal stories. Finally, I would like to use this opportunity to thank our main partner and contributor to this event, the Jewish Community Center in London, JW3, and especially a great gratitude to Judy. Thank you so much for your personal devotion and for your commitment to this event. So I hope you all have an enjoyable evening, and thank you very much for your support to the embassy in continuing this event and this tradition for 12 years. Thank you very much.
It's over to me. Hello, everybody. My name's Clive. I'm Clive Lawton. I've been asked to moderate. I hope it doesn't require too much moderating. But I've been asked to moderate this this panel session now. I've been long associated with JW3, in fact, before it existed. So I've been around quite a long time here. And I have an admission to make, which is that I have nothing whatsoever to do with the Litvak tradition. My own Jewish heritage doesn't even start to get across Germany, let alone anywhere else more eastern than that. So I've been learning about this over the years. But one of the things I learned, and indeed I gave a course here in JW3 about the Lithuanian-Polish Commonwealth, is how far-sighted the founding of Vilnius was, and how significant it included Jews pretty well from the very beginning. I was in Vilnius last year and saw the clock counting down to the beginning of the 700th year anniversary. We're now here. And I think we can all of us say that any relationship that lasts 70 years, let alone 700 years, it's going to have its ups and downs. And there have been ups and downs, certainly, with the Jews and Lithuania. But we're going to learn, I hope, a lot about those things. The title of this, you've got it. Oh, no, you haven't got it on the screen there. 1,000 Doors to the World. Well, that, of course, is not the whole world, but it's the Litvak world. 1,000 doors into that. We've got three presenters here, and I'm going to introduce them as we turn to them in turn. So first of all, I'm going to ask Professor Dr. Laima Lauchkaite. Did I get that right?
Yeah.
Oh,
I tried.
Okay.
Thank
right.
you.
Okay. I'm learning all the time, folks. My Lithuanian is not fluent. She's an art historian, curator. She's the leading researcher of the Lithuanian Institute of Culture, Philosophy, and Art Research. She's qualified in Vilnius and in Moscow and in Munich, so studied extensively, has published a book, Art in Vilnius, for example, and we're going to ask her to speak first, and then we'll follow through with our other two speakers. So, Laima.
Thank you. Can I have my slides? Oh, sorry. Okay, thank you. So I'm very happy to be here today with you, and as art historian, I am inviting you just to a short trip to Jewish Vilna in works of art that were created in the first half of the 20th century. These will be three key traditional places of Jewish Vilnius. Okay, and I would like to begin with the map of Vilnius and with the Jewish quarters. They are not very clearly indicated. Just near the Jewish quarters are just near the, also without color somehow, but actually the center is these are Jewish quarters, which actually are just near in the center of Old Town, near the city hall and the main street that is leading to the royal palace.
Excuse me, there's something wrong with the speaker.
There's an echo.
Really? Can you help?
We're getting a little bit of feedback on the microphone. Is there anything that can be done about that, please? Okay, let's try that now.
Yeah, so thank you. So these are medieval quarters that in where Jews lived since 15th century. Is that okay now or not?
Still not good?
Having problems?
Okay, now we've got a skilled technician.
Sorry.
No, that's quite right, too. He looks like a chap who knows what he's doing. Let's hope so. Let's try that.
Okay. So, actually, Jewish Vilna in art appeared rather late. It was only at the start of the 20th century. You know, earlier, those poor quarters, shabby, irregular, narrow streets didn't interest the artists. Oh.
One, two, three. Okay. No. Okay. Thank you. Those shabby quarters didn't interest the artist, as I have already told, in the, for example, 19th century, and only with the beginning of the 20th century, with the concept of the so-called romantic old town, the situation changed. Here you see the work of Stanislav Philibert Fleury and Mr. Stav Dobuzhinsky. Dobuzhinsky was especially interested in old Vilnius, and he was one of the first to paint those streets, irregular streets, those colorful houses, those colorful advertisements. He was a native of Vilnius. He went to St. Petersburg, but nevertheless he returned to Vilnius and made these picturesque places. And you know, the boom of Jewish Vilna appeared during the First World War. Well, it was for citizens very difficult time, but also a curious cultural phenomena took place at that time. The headquarters of German army established the so-called Pressed Department in Oberost. And in this department worked German intellectuals, journalists, writers, artists from the biggest liberal newspapers in Berlin. And many of them were of Jewish origin. And in Vilnius, they discovered a traditional Jewish community. On the one side, they saw its terrible poverty and sufferings. And at the same time, they were impressed by spiritual strength entrenched in the religion and traditions of ancestors. So they wrote in their text and depicted a Jewish environment. Mainly, these were three places that they were interested most of all. So number one, what you see here, the images. It is the old medieval quarters painted by Alfred Holler, Buhe, and these artists were simply fascinated with those narrow streets, arcs in the streets, brick buildings, colorful advertisements, and also crowds of people, because the old city, the Jewish quarters, were always full of people. The trade was going here in the streets. Also, those passages in the quarters, the yards, the very, very medieval views that they liked them very much. As you see here, Alfred Holler's Yadkova Street, or Walter Buche, the same Yadkova Street. A lot of such depictions appeared during the First World War. So, number two, the main holy place, certainly, the heart of Vilnius, is the Great Synagogue, which was built in the 17th century. There are two pictures. The picture by Kamarauskas, we see the front view of the Great Synagogue. Actually, it is a little bit imaginary picture, because this building, the Great Synagogue, was always compressed with other buildings. As you see here in another picture by Alfred Holler, a German painter, the Great Vilna Synagogue, where you can see only the front of this synagogue. So actually these views were very popular at that time. Another artist, Walter Buhe, was depicting, he has made many, many depictions of the Great Synagogue, but here you see it, how it looked from the, not from the view, but from the side view. And, well, people going to the serving, what they were very interested with snow in Vilnius, a lot of snow, and people just going into the synagogue for praying. The views also from the inside, what's going in the great synagogue. It had, the synagogue had four massive columns, the bima made in Baroque style, and you know how many, a lot of people coming to pray. And also those on the below pictures, you can see just the scenes from the great synagogue, where the Talmud readers, the service going on, and the last one on the below, on the right side, is very interesting, because actually the Great Synagogue was not only the place for prayers, but also the shelter for poor people who during the winter came just to warm themselves and at the stove, and you see them just standing and trying somehow to get warm in this place. So it was the shelter also important for them. And the third place, which was also very important for Vilnius Jews, it is the old cemetery of Snipišok. It is in the very center of the city with very peculiar tombs. These tombs were called ohels, just like little houses with roofs. And below, it is those two pictures below are from the depict the most famous place again in Snipišok Cemetery. It is the mausoleum of Vilna Gaon, the most influential rabbinic authority since Middle Ages, the Talmudist. Yes, and this house is that is depicted in the picture of Hermann Struck, and also the Alfred Holler. You see this house, the mausoleum, which was again the very important place. Very interesting traditional rites and festivities of Vilnius Jews were also captured by Alfred Buche. This artist worked for the newspaper Vilnair Zeitung, and he captured unique scenes. For example, here above, you see on the left side, it is the prayers at the grave tree of the Jewish martyr Gertzedek, coming just to pray at the tree. I think Laimonas will tell more us about this phenomena and this well, grave. Also, you see here, for example, the Pesach holiday preparations going on in the old, in the yards of Old City. For example, those grinders with mortars grinding the flour for matzos, and the woman waiting for this flour. Or, for example, the Sukkot festivity. It is the on the picture on the left side below, where we see the how Sukkots were made in the balconies of the old city with fir branches. The balconies are covered with fir branches, and that was the such an improvisation of the Sukkot. Also the scenes, well, those scenes of traditional Jewish life are actually very rare in the iconography of Vilnius. That's why they are interesting, just the drawings from this newspaper. And we are going now just to the interwar period, when actually then a lot of Jewish Vilna images appear. A lot of them were produced. Certainly, the most popular street was Yadkova Street, the street which had double arcs. You see in every of those pictures, the street with double arcs is shown, and the artists of various nationalities were depicting it. For example, this one on the left on above is by Ignaz Pinkas, Polish artist, the below of Bronislaw Jamont. He is also Polish artist. The rest on the below are several works by Litvak artists from New York who came in 20s to Vilnius just and depicted them. Elias Grossman, Lionel Rice. So these are not Vilnius artists, but they came and they considered these places to be the most important. And interesting, you see above the logo of the Yiddish literary group Jung Vilna, and they choose this motif of this double arcs in Yadkova Street as the logo for the group. So that was really this was the most important iconic motif of Jewish Vilna. The most famous artist from Vilnius was Moiver or Moishe Vorobeitchik. He was born in Vilnius, but he went to study in Bauhaus. And in Bauhaus, he studied the most contemporary, in the constructivist style, was working and made the photos of Vilnius, made the album, which was called Ein Ghetto in Osten Vilna. And it's very interesting that this album is very interesting because actually he is using the aesthetics, the style, absolutely modern, very contemporary, and the object itself, it's very traditional, very well related to those Jewish quarters He could certainly, well, depict, for example, the new Jewish Vilnius, the new, which was also very in the 20s, 30s, very lively, a lot of organizations and institutions and so on and so. But he, wanted to show in this album, which was, well, made especially for the Western public, certainly, just to show this, traditional old Vilnius. So that's why it's interesting. And quite in this year, in the Center Pompidou, there was a big exhibition of Moiver, and his photos from Vilnius were also from this photo album were also shown. And certainly what I have said, that most probably he's most famous in the West from all the artists that went from Vilnius. And the last one is the very sad work. As you see, the World War II came, the Jewish community population was, all the Jewish community was killed, and altogether the Jewish quarters were destroyed also. This is the work of Raphael Wallace. He was a Holocaust survivor. Just before World War II, he escaped to Soviet Russia, and when he returned home after war, this is a scene that he found, that so the ruins of the Great Synagogue looked like in 1945. So this was the end of the Jewish Vilna, of the Jewish community, and those Jewish quarters that were very, well, vibrant just before World War II. And, well, to finish this, my short presentation, I would like, with the title of today's event, Vilna, 1,000 Doors to the World, all these images that I have shown you today are kept in various places of the world. Several of them are from the Lithuanian museums, but very few, because certainly after Holocaust, for example, the Jewish legacy, the Jewish artistic legacy, did not survive. But the rest that I have shown you, I have found during my researches, and they are kept in the cultural institutions in Germany, Belgium, United States, Israel, and so on. So again, Vilna, 1,000 Doors to the World. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Well, we're going to, there's so much that we want to pick up on that, but we're going to move in and take all three presentations first, then we'll pick up. Next, we have Laimonas Briedis. Laimonas is a writer and scholar of history and literature and the geography of Vilnius. He's written Vilnius, City of Strangers. He has lived most of his adult life in Vancouver, and he completed his doctorate at the University of British Columbia, which has got little or nothing to do with Britain, but nevertheless, there it is.
Britain and Columbia.
And he's geography is his starting place, I think, really.
Yes.
And he's going to take us up further into Vilnius and its history.
So first of all, how is the sound? Everything's okay? So I don't need this. Is that okay?
Good. Yeah, I think we're okay with that.
Excellent. Can you hold it? Thank you very much for the introduction, and thank you for coming. And since we have only like basically 10, 15 minutes, so I'll be very brief. First of all, I want to say that with this wonderful images of that Laima show us, to remind that, yes, we're celebrating 700 years of the anniversary of the founding of Vilnius, but also 80 years of the destruction of Vilna ghetto. And I think the sort of the destruction of the ghetto in 1943 in the fall is probably the most watershed moment in the history of the city, of course, because we can talk about the city before and after. because this, and I'll talk a little bit, a bit about that. So there we have two anniversaries, so in my sort of talk, we have that to keep in mind. And another thing about this title, A Thousand Doors to the World, Vilna, A Thousand Doors to the World, I think you rightfully pointed out that this is, if we look from, so to speak, from London, is the entrance point into the Litvak world. But actually, I borrowed this title from the Moises Kulbach's poem, Vilna, written in 1926, actually, I believe, just before he left Lithuania, Vilnius for Belarus, and where he talks actually that this is actually literally opening the world, so to speak. So you leave Vilna and you're like entering the world. So it's very important that Vilna is this connector between the local world, and it's a very large local world, including what is most Belarus, like it's a Litvak world, but also the world, so to speak. So it's the kind of this interconnect intermediately for centuries that's between those two realities. So I'll talk about that. And I start actually also like with its 80th anniversary from the quote from the Israel Cohen's History of Vilna. It's published in Philadelphia, written in English. And you can tell from the date when it was published in 1943, it was exactly more or less published when the Vilna ghetto was destroyed. And he opens this with the sort of saying, the city of Vilna, which has played so notable a part in the history of Lithuanians, Poles, and the Jews, owes its origins according to local tradition to a dream. And as Lithuanians all know, and not just Lithuanians, suppose there's a dream that he talks about the Grand Duke of Gediminas, who sort of had a dream about iron wool howling very loudly. And then he goes to the priest, the pagan priest, and said, you know, what the hell is going on? You know, I have this disturbing dream, so to speak. And the priest said, well, you know, it's very simple. It means that you have to build a castle in the city, and the city is going to be like, you know, as loud, so to speak, and known around the world as you, that sound of wolves. Now, subsequently, I found that in Lithuanian mythology, dreaming about wolf means to expect guests. Not sure how that's connected, but I'll take that, so to speak. So Vilnius is from the beginning in a way, and this is really the history from the initial beginnings recorded, he says, is the city that is very much opens to the world, because the first instance is about welcoming the foreigners and strangers to come into the city and settle, actually. Now, the rest is, so to speak, is the history, right? Another point that I want to make out, and this I think is just a very wonderful image, that this very intricate connection between the city and nature, and especially built environment and the forest. So the city is surrounded by the forest, and there's a very good reason why it was built in the forest. And in fact, for centuries, especially in German tradition, it was called Die Wilde, which literally means the wilderness, right? So it's the oxymoron, how the city and wilderness can come together. But, you know, that's the story of Vilnius. So, but here's the sort of other tradition and Jewish tradition. And again, so a quote from the Moshe Kulbach and Abba Sutkovner. One is writing in Yiddish, another writing in Hebrew. And parallel with the Vilna Gaon map of Jerusalem, that supposed to be was found in 1802, made in 1802, after already was gone, like dead. So it's from his kind of narrative imagination of Jerusalem. Now, many probably of you know that Vilna Gaon wanted to go to Jerusalem and went to Jerusalem. He didn't make it, I think, if I'm correctly, he stopped somewhere in Amsterdam and didn't make it in return. But of course, this kind of like idea that like connecting Vilnius to Jerusalem, I think it's a very strong one already before this myth was established that Vilna is the Jerusalem of Lithuania, Jerusalem of the North. So Moshe Kulbach compares Vilna to a dream of a Kabbalist, gray drifting in the universe, cobwebbed in the early autumn. I think this is really very magical sort of kind of like essence of capturing the essence of the city. And Abba Kovner, writing already in Israel, about his hometown, this city where my parents' house stood in the suburbs where we sang folk songs was called by Jews the Jerusalem of Lithuania, because everything of Jerusalem was there except for Zion and Jerusalem. So Lima mentioned about the Gerd Zedek, and we can talk a little bit more perhaps about Gerd Zedek, but Gerd Zedek's symbols, that everything was, so to speak, learned about Jewish past in the city. This is from, This is from the Lyusha Davidovich, an American who spent 1933 from 1939 in Vilnius, said that Jews learn actually everything about this history in the cemeteries. So it was kind of essential in the Jewish cemetery. And one of them was this wonderful tree, strangely shaped tree, Gerd Zedek's tree, that supposed to grew out of his grave, that Polish legionaries chopped down it in the 1920 or something like that. So it's a kind of like a form of pogrom. Actually, it was a pogrom, and the Jewish legionaries who occupied the city at the time chopped the tree too, in a way, to destroy that sort of connection, that mythological connection between the city and the forest and the Jewish imagination, if you want to call that. So we really don't know very much about when the Jewish community was established, when the first Jewish, you know, families kind of come to Vilnius. What we do know, actually, more or less, when the Jewish diaspora from Vilnius started to evolve, and it's actually started in the 17th century with the Muscovite occupation of the city of Vilnius. And this is from the rabbi Moses Rivka's sort of description how they fled the city. Everybody fled the city, including the Jews. And it's kind of like, you know, the title of this narrative is Well of Exile. Right, so it's already like give you an idea that Vilna was considered to be home, and the Jews who left Vilna at the time were already in exile, the second exile perhaps, but nonetheless, it's like. Now, Moses Rivkus ended up in Amsterdam, and actually I think became one of the first Ashkenazi rabbis in Amsterdam because they have a Sephardic rabbi. So this is give you a description. Another formula sort of imagining the city and imagining as a center of Lithuania is kind of like reading parallel poetic kind of notion. So here's the description of Adam Mickiewicz from Pan Tadeusz, like very famous Polish writer who was basically Lithuanian Vilna native, or Vilnius native, or Vilna native. And he said, "Oh, Lithuania, my homeland, you are the health alone, your worth only can ever be known by one who's lost you. Today I see, I tell anew your lovely beauty as I long for you." And here's the Abraham Tsitskever writing in already in Israel in 1950, kind of like, you know, echoing this kind of like Mickiewicz poem. "All Lithuania, homeland mine, serpents bite in my heart, storks vaulted in my memory over your black forests. Like Kabbalist signs gild the rims where your fir trees wrestle on Vilnius' banks. The body burners are your fire witnesses. And when I walk in the streets of Jerusalem in the rain, it is diamond mirror, I see their souls in wound colors. Living brother, give us meaning." And I think this is kind of like establishing the connection, not just like necessary mythological connection between Jerusalem and Vilna, but actually kind of like a living connection between Jerusalem and in memory of the city of Vilna in Jerusalem. But we know that Gaon's followers established one of the first Ashkenazi synagogues that this day is there in Jerusalem. So there's a kind of physical connection, right? But Vilnius itself continued to be this sort of kind of like a city where things were happening, especially among the sort of for Jewish community in the 19th century. And this is a quote from another Vilnius native, Benjamin Harshav, who was the professor of Hebrew and Slavic literature at Yale. And it's also like, is that something I did? Okay. And Benjamin Harshav grew up in Vilnius. And so his description of the city before basically, you know, he came into the world is that what I'm like interesting that it's really parallels to Oxford and Cambridge, to a college town. Now, this is a fascinating thing because actually university at that time, there was no university, the Russian authorities closed university. And it's precisely because of these kind of young Jewish people would come into the city and you know, gather some kind of like knowledge, and then through immigration would go out of the city. So then when I mentioned this kind of connector, these kind of doors, that the doors were opening in and out, right? So parallel that to Oxford and Cambridge in that sense, or Jena and Weimar. Now, in the essence, this still was the center of this what is considered to be Yiddish world. This is kind of like a wonderful map of the world, or atlas actually, printed in Vilna in 1922, all in Yiddish. It also includes the map of Poland. It also includes the map of Lithuania and Europe. This is kind of greater Europe. And Max Weinreich, who established the Yiva in Vilna, this is kind of a quote that Vilna in the Jewish world stands much greater. Hello?
Okay.
Much sort of a greater than Vilnius, Vilna in sort of other parallel universes. And when I talk Vilnius, it's, it would be Lithuanian more or less universe, Vilna would be Polish universe, there's also Belarusian, you can argue, and Russian and Germans, right? So because of this presence, of the cultural presence of the city, Vilna will have to figure out on the map in larger letters than Vilnius, Vilna, Vilna in non-Jewish map. Now, this is not like how everyone looked like or like appeared to like understood Vilna at the time. Here's the kind of like several images with a poem. Liza Wolf was not like Jung Vilna, but he was Jung Valdix, what they called people, another new generation of the poets, post Jung Vilna poems. And this is his poem about sort of imagining leaving Vilnius, right? Vilna has become ugly to me, with its mangy ghetto streets, off into the wide world, join a circus, become president of America, or king of England, or crocodile in the Nile, or a poem in an amazing style. It's almost kind of Dadaist, kind of like imagination, right? But here's the Canada, like very important painter in Brazil, the sort of the establisher of the modern Brazilian art, if you want to call, Lazar Segal, who also grew up in Vilnius. And this is kind of like his and this kind of essence. He left Vilnius in 1919, finally, and so complete distancing himself. And another image at the same time, he put the Eternal Walkers, and actually this painting was confiscated by the Nazis and put into the degenerate art sort of exhibition. So it's like as an example of the Jewish degenerative art. Now, this is another kind of like almost like a parallel images of Vilna, right? So we have a Michael Chagall's image of Vilna synagogue, and then Lazar Segal's almost at the same time painting imagining of the war in Vilnius, people crowding into the ghetto. Even if you didn't hear much about the ghetto at the time, I mean, this kind of like a part of imagination. So it's one of this kind of very wonderful, magical place, and another, it's really kind of like, you know, basically. Now, briefly about the statistics, and when I mentioned the sort of destruction of the ghetto and change of the nature of the world, it's very important because before the war, for at least good part of the century, if not more, the city was more or less Catholic, Polish, and Jewish, right? So it's a kind of like in different variations. Now, after the war, it's really shifted. So the Jewish population basically like, you know, kind of like minimal become, and it's increasingly smaller and smaller and smaller, and it becomes more and more Lithuanian. So the kind of the different narratives start to be built. And, you know, here we're talking about Vilna, but in the essence now we can question and ask a question is who has obligation, if you want to call it, a right, so to speak, to talk about Vilna? Is it the people who inhabit the city today, mostly Lithuanians and Polish, who have practically non-connection to the city, or this kind of memories and the people who have a kind of like connection, family connection perhaps to the city, but they don't live in the city, right? So it's a kind of like dual narrative. And so here's the perfect example of Vilnius, for example, during the Soviet period, where you have all the churches, but not a single like mentioning of any kind of Jewish life synagogue. And I like to say, I see this in the, for example, map of Leeds, right, with Jewish Leeds, where you have a very prominent Vilna synagogue, like in the middle, so kind of like, so this, here again we have this. And then I would like to end with this list Segal's. This was with his last painting, actually, where he imagined fused the Lithuanian forest around Vilnius with the Brazilian forest. So the kind of this idea of fusing together them. This is, I think, is his last painting where he was completely blind, basically, and painted blindly. And then, you know, again, I will finish with Abba Kovner's quote about the sort of connection between Vilna and Jerusalem. Vilna no longer exists. Vilna without Jerusalem in the mind's eye is not the Jerusalem of Lithuania. However, and I think that's the key, will Jerusalem without the Jerusalem of Lithuania remain Jerusalem? Thank you very much. So, okay. Thank you.
Well, and last but by no means least, we've got Professor Berkowitz. Michael is American. You'll hear from his accent. But he's based now in the UK. He's a professor of modern Jewish history at University College London. Particularly interested in Jews and photography. But over to you now, Michael.
All right, thank you very much. Can everyone hear? Yes? Okay. Well, I'm also an imposter, but in a different way. That is, I am connected to Lithuania almost everywhere outside of Vilnius. Do you want me to use this mic?
Hello? Yes, okay. Well, as I said, I am an imposter. That is, I am connected to places in Lithuania outside of Vilna or Vilnius. That is, my grandparents came from Pašušvēs and Šaukotas, which are very small shtetls, and other members of my family lived in Kovno or Kaunas. So almost, you know, different from other places. And I can also say very sadly that my great-grandparents were murdered as Lithuanians in Krok, which is not that far from the town that they lived in the sweep of the Einsatzgruppen of the Nazis in 1941. I myself have taken many groups of students to Lithuania for study tours, and this, of course, was interrupted due to COVID, but I would love to have an opportunity to do that again. Mainly, I want to talk about a couple colleagues of mine. The first one is a Richard who is very much around, who some of you might know, Richard Schofield, who has founded a center for Litvak photography, who's really doing amazing work, and I was really thrilled to hear my colleague here talk about Moy Ver, who I think was an incredible photographer. He spent most of his later life, though, as an artist in Sfat or Safed, but his photography is really extraordinary, and he was, in many ways, way ahead of Roman Vishniak and many other people who are now associated with modernist trends. Incredibly talented photographer, and there were some others as well, such as Isis, and again, it's a kind of thing I could talk about rather extensively, but I mainly want to talk about a dear friend of mine who died very recently. That is Richard Freund, who was born in 1955, and he died in July of 2022. He was a professor at Christopher Newport University in Newport News, Virginia. He had spent most of his career before that at the University of Hartford in Connecticut and the University of Nebraska at Omaha. And he was one of the lead figures in the Schulhof Research Project, that is for the Great Synagogue and Schulhof of Vilna, which actually had started in 2011, and then they brought him on board because he was one of the world's great expert in this ground-penetrating radar, which meant he was able to do sort of non-invasive archaeology, which was really incredible, and they were able to map so much of the place. He also was involved in the archaeological work of the excavation of this escape tunnel at Ponar. That is, we'd always known that this had existed, but we didn't know exactly where it was or its precise character until he worked with a team of people and did this. And thankfully, this now appears as a Nova series in public television in the United States. It's been shown all over. But I want to say that along with John Seligman and other Harry Jowell and other people, again, Richard did this work, and he always acknowledged his teams, particularly the people who did the technical aspects. There's now a book that's out by my colleague Phil Reeder from Duquesne University in Pittsburgh, which is basically dedicated to Richard and his work. And Richard was able to publish a book which was partly on the subject called The Archaeology of the Holocaust, Vilna, Roads, and Escape Tunnels. And as I said, he really was an extraordinary figure, and I think if he had lived longer, he would have continued to do absolutely incredible work. But the last thing I want to say, which connects to what both of my colleagues have talked about, is I think what really attracted Richard in the very beginning to the Schulhof project was that it was in some ways kind of like a JCC before its time. That is, although it was this traditional synagogue, everyone met there. That is, poor, rich, okay, they maybe didn't get along with each other, people of various political stripes, again, very different kinds of characters, but it was a place where everyone would gather, and he found this incredibly exciting because Richard had a very broad vision of Jews and Jewish life and really wanted to investigate it to its fullest. And I think one of the greatest descriptions that we have of this is in a film which is very underrated and not shown a lot. It's a really long film, but worth seeing, that is Josh Waletzki's Partisans of Vilna, which is from 1986. And in the very beginning of, not quite the very beginning is Abakovner talking about the moment they realized that what the Nazis were doing to the Jews was not normal, that it wasn't simply massacres, that it was a systematic extermination. And this is what led them to establish their partisans organization. I realize some people might disagree with me about this, but the only places where there were really united partisan organizations, that is, against the Nazis, were in Vilna and Kovno. That is, Jews almost anywhere else did not succeed in bringing people together the way that happened in this place. But what Abakovner does in this film is to describe what the scene was like at this great synagogue, which was unlike anything he had ever seen anywhere else or anywhere since. Anyway, again, I just want mainly to recall my dear friend and colleague, Richard Freund, my very much alive friend and colleague, Richard Schofield, and I'm happy to talk about any of this. Again, sorry for not having a PowerPoint prepared, but I'm happy to share in particular things about photography that I've been working on for quite a long time, and I appreciate being part of this Litvak Days event. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. No, I'm all right. Well, it's interesting that you picked up on the sort of universality of those who attended the synagogue. I noticed in one of the pictures that you showed, Lema, that in the foreground you had people coming out of the synagogue, and in the foreground you had, I suppose one would almost say, stereotypic interwar, poorish Jews, you know, wrapped up and so on. But also there were two or three men standing around with cylinders, with top hats. So you knew you were getting the kind of the rich and the fancy, along with the ordinary and the poor in there. Well, lots of material to explore, and I'm going to give time for questions or comments from the floor. Yeah, no, I know, not much time, because we've got more entertainment coming on. But just before I come to questions from the audience, I said before, didn't I, that 700 years of relationship is going to have its ups and downs. And we've heard a lot about the remarkable status of Vilna in the Jewish geography, far beyond its numbers would suggest. I think most Jews are astonished to discover that Lithuanian Jewry was probably never bigger than British Jewry is now, a couple of 100,000, 300,000 perhaps, unlike the millions in Poland, for example, or indeed the couple of million that were in the Soviet Union before it broke down. It's a comparatively small community. It was not the size of Spanish Jewry, even in the Middle Ages. A comparatively small community, and yet nevertheless, reverberating around the Jewish world and creating a cultural form that is definable. I mean, a Litvak Jew is a different kind of Jew to another kind of Jew. And not just in terms of kind of how you pronounce your Yiddish or how you make your gefilte fish, but actually how you think and learn and study. But the downside of this also, and of course I'm pleased that you addressed it, is that despite these fabulous things that all went horribly wrong during the Holocaust, and the community was crushed and destroyed, and probably the largest proportion, the highest proportion of Jews to be destroyed in a national community was in Lithuania. It was well over 90% of Lithuanian Jews killed in that situation. I live in Bristol, and Bristol has struggled with its own statue wars recently. You mentioned the Muscovite invasion And we know that in Kiev, I think it's in Kiev in the Ukraine, there's a statue to Khmelnytsky, who no doubt is a fabulous guy for them,
right.
But a rather worrying fellow for the Jews, who killed thousands and thousands. And there are folk who are understandably heroes to Lithuanians because of their own fight for national independence and so on, who are problematic to Jews in terms of their participation, enthusiastic or passive, with the Nazi destruction of the Jews. And I wonder whether how Vilna, or Vilnius now, as a modern city, looking back on its history, articulates and responds to the extent to which Lithuania did or didn't play a part in the destruction of the Jews. It's a problem I know that Poland, for example, is finding indescribably difficult to deal with.
Can you hear me? I think it's a very good question that it's still in any form or shape to sort of resolve or at least even address in a very meaningful way. And one of the reasons, actually, I want to mention is that this, people always, first of all, about the importance of Vilna, for example, and even, like, as you mentioned, Litvak. So one thing I want to say that the reason why it's a small community but was, so to speak, so looms so large is that in the city of Vilnius, for example, not a single, so to speak, religion, language dominates or dominated historic for a long enough period to impose some kind of, like, you know, very strongly hierarchical system. There's always hierarchies. So Jews and Jewish culture are always allowed to be a part of it, so to speak, rather than just kind of like, you know, the assimilation process was not as much as, for example, in Poland or Russia, Germany.
And if I may say so, you mentioned talking to a pagan priest.
Right.
Lithuania was the last country in Europe to give up paganism. And it's partly because it had problems with the Teutonic Knights and so on. But nevertheless,
right.
It remained kind of non-committal in many ways.
Oh, absolutely. So, like, but yeah. To answer your question, I think, you know, there's that saying that, you know, history is the past, you know, it's the past country, and they do things differently there. Now, I can speak only about Vilnius, so Lithuania, it's a little bit different. Now, you have to remember that Vilnius, so to speak, up until World War II, basically, was not part of Lithuania, so to speak. Mm. So it was part of Poland. And then, of course, part of the Russian Empire and German, et cetera, et cetera. So I think it's a very difficult, the way it's kind of this history frame for Lithuanians and for Lithuanian as it is today, to kind of realize, and as I even mentioned, what kind of responsibilities, you know, and it's, sometimes it's very convenient because, oh, it was under Poles.
Right.
Oh, it was under Germans. Oh, it was under Soviets. So, but it's true, that's also true, that many things were not in sort of under the, so to speak, Lithuania. And yet, on the other hand, Lithuanians claim, you know, that Vilnius is the capital of Lithuania from the beginning. So there is a certain responsibility of things that went wrong, even if there was under different regimes, so to speak. So I think it's a question of sort of how. In fact, I think it's even a larger question how Lithuanians recognize Vilnius as part of themselves or part of their own history, and yet simultaneously part of something else. And I think this line I probably would agree, that this kind of constant, it's not even tension, but this constant searching for that, sort of for connecting those things.
What?
Oh.
This part, with any. Nearly 5 o'clock and we need to get Maria on. Obviously, we should have programmed 5 hours for this.
Well,
I forgot
have.
To say at
but
the
why
first.
Not? We have. On Tuesday night.
Yes.
So two things. One is at 6 o'clock when we finish the program, you are invited to stay and have a glass of wine. There's glasses there. There will be wine. And have an informal chat. So then you can ask the questions that you'd like to ask. And I'll also pose the ones that have come in on Zoom. Thank you for those. But I want to take this opportunity to make sure we have enough time for Maria, who is wonderful. So I'm going to thank the panel and Clive. Thank you so much, all of you. And please take your seats. Let's thank them first. And then if you'd like to take your seats in the audience.
Sorry, Judy, we as...
And so Tuesday evening. Very important.
So very important.
And we have, Limus is going to be speaking about a whole evening, an hour, on Vilnius. So please come back on Tuesday and join us for that at 7:30.
Yes, do come back, folks. We've got a good opportunity there to explore these matters much more fully. And now we're going to hear from Maria Krupavec, who's the vocalist and guitarist. And we've got Borisas Kisneris, who is the person on violin. So they've got to set up a little bit. We're going to get out their way, and we'll go from there.
Enough to be in Kaunas in the September for a very special Litvak seminar. And one of the concerts we had one evening was with Maria. And when we started talking about today, I suggested that that would be a very nice musical element. And Ulla, having heard of her, she's very well renowned, agreed. And I'm so delighted that you brought Maria over. So now please give a huge welcome to Maria and Borisa.
Vilna, you have psalms built in clay and iron, each stone a prayer, a hymn every wall, as great Moshe Kulbach wrote. Your every wall is a psalm. The other poet almost 100 years ago in New York wrote the words, Vilna, city of spirit and quiet prayers. Vilna, conceived in Jewish ways. How often I see you in my dreams, your forests, hills, and valleys, and the old Vilna ghetto. How often your name calls forth a tear in my eye. Stadt von Geist und Mimes, Vilna Hiddisch Lechvartrag, wo es murmeln stillet vieles, stillet heut es von der Nacht. Oft mal ich seh ich dich in Hohen, es geliebte Vilna Mann. Die alte Wiener Ghetto in a nebeligen Schein. Wilne, Wilne, unser Heimstadt, unser Bänkschaft und Lager. Ach, wie oft es ruht dein Namen in mein Eugaräuzatrer. Wilner Gesslach, Wilner Teichen, Wilner Wälder, Park und Tor. Etwas Neues, etwas bängt sich noch die Zeiten von Amor. In sein Schatten ein Gehirn, wo geheim es hoben Lehrer unser Wissen durchgestiehlt. Wilne holt den ersten Faden von der Freiheit zum Gewehr und die Liebe Kinder ihre mit der zarten Geist ballen. Wilne, Wilne, unser Heimstadt, unser Denkschaft und Wagen. Ach, wie oft es ruht dein Namen und mein Eugaräus hat er. Wilne, Gesslach, Wilner Teichen, Wilner Wälder, Park und Tor. Etwas Neues, etwas bein sich noch die Zeit und remember those sweet times when we were still children, when our father would ask what we had learned at school. And what was a joy when our father would sing Zmires, a Shabbos chant, that the holy temple would be rebuilt. It seems that the Jews of Vilna would strive to rebuild the temple by their way of life, sanctifying life in prayers, studying the Torah, and supporting those in need. Gedenkst du jene süße Zeiten, wenn wir seinen Kindern noch geben und die Mame pflegt uns dann begleiten, wenn wir pflegen in Heider gehen und der Tate pflegt schreien im Gelelern. Weil was sind uns zu zeigen noch? Weil es schade ist, will der Tate, will Herrn, was du hast gelernt die ganze Woche. Und Schabes fliegt der Tate, so ein junger Mann. Oh, mir Herrn, es geht. Und wenn du fliegst nicht gerne, fliegt er mit dem Kantchen. Arrein, dann pflegt man da den Milde mit Aminien und Nidbekides. Es legt wern doch sein a größe Simche, wenn der Tate es pflegt in Gensemires bei dem Schale Schiedes. Oh, I bonne, 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 I in Yiddish. Let everyone see that I am alive and can sing better than ever. Play me a song about peace. May all nations, big and small, understand that it is the time to quit the wars. The lyrics were written by the poet Josip Kotlar, who lived in Vilnius after the war. ¶¶
spiel sie mir ein Lied alle in Jiddisch. Der Wecken soll es fremd und nicht geliedisch. Als alle groß und klein sollen können das verstehen. Von Mäuel zu Mäuel das Lied alle soll gehen. Ai, 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 spiel, spiel, klezmer und spiel. Weißt du, was ich mein und was ich will? Spiel, spiel, spiel ein Liedele für mir, spiel ein Liedele mit Herz und mit Gefühl. Liedele und siebzehn und Tränen. Spiel also, als alle sollen hören, als alle sollen sehen, ich lebe und singen kann, schöner noch und besser wie gewesen. Oi, 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 spiel, spiel, klezmer und spiel, weißt doch, was ich mein und was ich will. Spiel, spiel, spiel ein Liedele für mir, spiel ein Liedele mit Herz und mit Gefühl. Wegen Scholem, so steht schon Scholem nicht will holen. Als Völker groß und klein, so gerne das verstehen und kriegen nun Milchone sich begehen. Oi, 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 spiel, spiel, klezmer und spiel, weiß doch, was ich mein und was ich will. Spiel, spiel, spiel ein Liedele für mir. Spiel ein Liedele mit Herz und mit Gefühl. Oi, 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 spiel, spiel, klezmer und spiel, weiß doch, was ich mein und was ich will. Spiel, spiel, spiel ein Liedele für mir. Spiel ein Liedele mit Herz und mit Gefühl.
Boris Kirzner. Pre-war, Vilna Jewish community was thriving. Among others, there was a choir conducted by Jakob Gerstein. So he never married, so all the girls in Vilnius, in Vilna, were very much interested in him. Fortunately, unfortunately, he died before the Holocaust. And the repertory of the choir has been preserved in the Ivo archives in New York. I went there sometimes to study Yiddish folklore with the great Hanna Mlotek. And she suggested me to study those songs that this choir was singing. By the way, the choir sang Handel's Hallelujah in Yiddish. They took pride in this. And one of their songs was Du sollst nicht gehen mit Kindern Mädelech. Nothing specifically Jewish in this, is this song. It's just a melody of foxtrot. Actually, tango and foxtrot were so much popular everywhere, and some Jewish composers as Oskar Strock and some other, Alexander Olshanetsky, who wrote the great hit Ich hab dich so viel lieb, so they were Jewish. So now we will sing this lively song, Du sollst nicht gehen. There is a refrain without words, so you can join us if you would like to. And it will be followed by also beloved songs. You might know it. It's so much popular. It's the song Sapochkelech. I will follow you wherever you go. I will sell some small items on the market, or I will even wash someone's floors in order to be with you, because I without you and you without me, like a door without a handle. Du sollst nicht gehen mit kein anderen Mädel. Du sollst nur kommen zu mir. Du sollst nicht gehen bei den Mannen Stiebele. Nur sollst du kommen zu mir. Ayalalala, 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 ayalalala. Das Liebe fängt sich um von der Schmeichel, von der Schmeichel bis zu Akisch. Es nimmt darauf beim Klicksten dem Seichel, doch siehst du mehr, alle machtest du nicht. Ayadadadam, ayadadadam, ayadadadadadadadam, ayadadadadam, ayadadadadadadam, ayadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadadad
Vos is do singele, vos i hopliv, ni token gesale, ni token stibale, ni to do singele, vos i hopliv. Ayaladaram, ayalandaram, ayaladaram, ayaladaram, ayalandaram, ayaladaram, ayaladaram.
Grüßen Dank.
Musik.
Verkäufen diese Puschkele und fahren auf die Droschkele, hab ich mit dir eine zu sein. Oh, ich und ihr und du und mir, oh, wie ein Klanke ohne Tier, Kätzle, du Fegele, du mein. Ai, ja, da, 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 da. Ay da 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 da. Oh, es noch na Tischale und schlopf noch na Kischale, adi mi dir neine zu sein. Oh, ich und ihr und wohl mir, oh, wie a Klanke ohne Tier, Kätzele, du Serzele, du mein. Ay, ja, da, 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 la, 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 ja, da, 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 la, da, la, 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 ay, ja, da, 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 la, da, 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 ay, ja, da, 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 la, da, 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 ay, la, da, 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 la, da, 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 la, da, 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 ay, la, da, la, da, ay, ja, la, da. Schlopft auf die Wachsalechlach und verkäufen fremde Schalechlach, hab ich mit dir in einem zu sein. Oh, ich und dir und du und mir, oh, ihr Vieh, a Klanke ohne Tier, Kätzle, du Feigele, du mein. Ayadatai, da 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 da, ayadatai, da 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 da, ayadatai, da 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 da. Ay da 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 da, ay da 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 da, ay da 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 da, ay da da.
Love. All the hopes of Privo Jewish community of Vilna were destroyed by the Shoah. However, hope against hope found its way in the spiritual resistance of the Vilna ghetto. Avrom Sutskever, great Vilna poet, would write, "Even death we can turn into a miracle." And the songs composed in the Vilna ghetto is a kind of a miracle. So the first song from the Vilna ghetto is Freeling. I hope you know this song very well. It was written by Vilna poet Shmerke Kachurginsky after his wife was shot. "I'm wandering in the ghetto and cannot find my beloved. Oh, spring, take me on your blue wings where my happiness is." Thank you.
Gehen ghetto von Gessel zu Gessel und kennen nicht gefinnen kein Ort. Nicht o ist mein Lieber, wie trockt mein Rieber, Menschen sagt, hoch a Wort. Es läuft auf mein Heimitz, der Himmel, der Bläuer, was je hab ich jetzt, der Fun. Ich steh wie ein Bettler, baiet wie ein Teuer und bettel ein bisschen Sohn. Frühling, nimm zu mein Treuer und bring mein Liebsten, mein Treuen zurück. Frühling, auf deine Flügel blühen, oh nimm mein Herz mit und bring es zu mein Glück. Frühling, auf deine Flügel blühen, oh nimm mein Herz mit und bring es zu mein Glück. Es ist heuer der Frühling, gor früh und gekommen. Se blit hat sich Bergschaft noch dir. Ich seh dir wie jetzt der Ballon mit Blumen, a freudiger gehst du zu mir. Die Sonne hat vergossen, die Welt hängt im Strahl, zersprotzt hat die Erde noch in Grün. Mein Treuer, mein Liebster, wo bist du verfallen? Gehst nicht raus von mein Sinn. Frühling, nimm zu mein Treuer und bring mein Liebsten, mein Treuer zurück. Frühling, auf deine Flügel blühe, und nimm mein Herz mit. Und bring es zu mein Glück, Frühling, auf deine Flügel blühen, oh nimm mein Herz mit und bring es zu mein Glück.
One more song from the Vilna Ghetto. It's called Isrolik. And this is about a small boy who, having lost everyone, is just trying to survive in the ghetto. He sells small things and he says he's very brave. He has this chutzpah. But when no one sees, he cries because he is all alone, like a wind in the field.
Ну кой вже папіросли, ну кой вже сахарі, Гевор із хань схої рибілі гве. Але бен фара грош, а пруте афара діс, фун гетто хендлер хот іх дох. Heis Isrolik, bin das Kind vom Ghetto. Heis Isrolik, ach hefker dicker Jung. Hoch verblieben, gole netto, der lange Hals noch als Wische und als Jung. A mantel na kragen, tachtoj nim funazak, kaloschen schobik svel nur dischi. Nor veres vet nor vagen, zu lang oja sa, dem ich vel beweisen, wer ich bin. Heis Isrolik,
Bindos kin fun ghetto. Hey, sis rolig, ach hefker diger jung. Hoch war blieben gole netto. Der lange Hals noch has fische un azul. Nit meint mich hot geborn. Ach hefker dike gas. Wat hatte mame hoi geben a ki. Hot beide hon geborn. Nit meint es is a spaß. Ich bin geblieben wie in feld. Der wie. Heis is rolig. Nor wenn keiner seht nit, wisch ich still. Von euch herob hat er, nor von mein Treuer, besser als mir rett nit, zu was der Monel nun machen's hartig schwer. Mein Treuer, besser als mir rett nit, zu was der Mone, nun machen's hartig schwer.
The hymn of the Vilna Ghetto, that later became also the anthem of the Warsaw Ghetto, was written by a young poet, Hirsch Glik, who was killed in the partisan fights while being only 21. This song has become actual again, unfortunately. Don't say you're going to your last fight. Our time has come, we are here. And our song will go like a hymn from generation to generation, like the call for freedom.
Sag nicht keinem, als du gehst dem letzten Weg, hoch hin und leine, verstellen bloje te. Kommen wird noch unser ausgebänkter Schor. Es wird abbeugt und unser Trott mir seinen Dor. Kommen wird noch unser ausgebänkter Schor. Es wird abbeugt und unser Trott mir seinen Dor. Von grünem Palmenland bis weißen Land von Schnee. Wir kommen an mit unser Pein, mit unser Weh. Und vor Gefall ist ein Spritz von unser Blut. Sprotzen wird dort unser Gwure, unser Mut. Und wo gefallen ist ein Spritz von unser Blut. Sprotzen wird dort unser Gwure, unser Mut. Es wird die Morgensum vergilden uns dem Heim. Und der Nächten wird verschwinden mit dem Feind. Und euch versammeln ist die Sonne und der Kajor. Wie a Parol soll gehen das Lied von dort zu dort. Und euch versammeln ist die Sonne und der Kajor. Wie a Parol soll gehen das Lied von dort zu dort. Das Lied geschrieben ist mit Blut und nicht mit Blei. Es ist nicht kein Liedl von a Vogel auf der Frei. Das hat a Volk zwischen fallen dicke Wände. Das Lied gesungen mit Nagales mit die Hände. Das hat ein Volk zwischen fallen dicke Wände. Das Lied gesungen mit Nagales in die Hände. Das sag nicht kein Mal, als du gehst dem letzten Weg. Hoch himmeln bleine, verstellen bloje Tag. Kommen wird noch unser ausgebänkter Schor. Es wird abbeugt und unser Trott mir seinen Dor. Kommen wird noch unser ausgebänkter Schor. Es wird abbeugt und unser Trott mir seinen Dor.
Now we will play a song that is well known in the whole world. Once it was sung by John Baez in English, but originally, Donna Donna, originally it's written in Yiddish soon after the Holocaust by two New York authors, Aaron Zeitlin and Jacob Jacobs. By the way, Aaron Zeitlin spent his childhood in Vilna, so he's also a Vilna Mensch. And this is about that those who have wings will never be the slaves. And you can sing together, sing along.
Liegt gebunden mit Astrid. Hoch in Himmel flieht a Schwelbel, flieht und dreht sich hin und zurück. Lacht der Wind in Korn, lacht und lacht und lacht. Lacht er auch a Toga ganzen und die ganze Nacht. Donna, 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 Dos Kelbel sagt der Poier, wer je heißt dich sein Akal. Wollst du besser sein a Feugel, wollst du besser sein a Schwal. Lacht der Wind in Korn, lacht und lacht und lacht. Lacht er ob a Toga ganzen, in die halbe Nacht. Donna, 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 Donna. Bidne Kälblach tut men binden, unse schert, unse schert. Wenn's hot Fliegel flieht, er ruft zu und war keine Mietkenkner. Lacht der Wind in Korn, lacht und lacht und lacht. Lacht er ob a Toga ganzen und die ganze Nacht. Donna, 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 zusammen, Donna, 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 Donna.
Thank you very much for singing along.
Now, Boris will play Doina, a tune in which it seems all the grief and pain of Jewish people is expressed. By this, we would like to honor the victims of the terror. And this tune will be followed by the song composed in the Vilna ghetto by Leib Rosenthal. We live forever. All the world is in fire, and our sonim try to distract us. But we will live. We will live through. We will overcome. We are here.
Der Welt. Wir leben ewig ohne Groschen Geld und auf Zeppelin ist die alle Sonne, was will uns versparzen unser Ponim. Wir leben ewig, wir seien dort. Wir leben ewig in jeder Schor. Wir will leben und erleben schwarze Zeichen überleben. Wir leben ewig, wir seien tot. leben ewig, es brennt a Welt. Mir leben ewig, ohne Groschen Geld. Und auf Zepiken ist, die alle Sony, was will uns verschwarzen, unser Pony. Mir leben ewig, mir seinen da. Mir leben ewig, in jeder Schor. Wir werden leben und erleben, schwarze Zeiten überleben. Wir leben ewig, wir seien da. Wir wollen leben und erleben, schwarze Zeiten überleben. Wir leben ewig. Wir leben ewig. Wir seien
finishing our program today, tonight, two songs about what will happen when the Messiah comes. So, different prophets will do, because it will be a great, great feast. Moses will preach, because he gave the law, the Torah. King David, of course, he will sing and dance. And the Messiah himself will sit on his golden throne. He will take a chalice with new wine and will bless the whole land. In the next song, Vilna poet Szmerki Kaczorginski, after the Holocaust, wrote the following words. Don't be naive. This generation is very sinful. But maybe for the sake of the thickening of darkness, Messiah will come sooner. Maybe he will hear our prayerful tune. Let our salvation come soon. Let the Messiah come.
Sabor, Messiah wird kommen, einzigsten Jahr. Oh, Jomel, we Jomel, is das Sabor. Messiah wird kommen, einzigsten Jahr. Wetter gekommen zu vorn, will sein guter Jahr. Wetter gekommen zu reiten. Wenn sein die gute Zeiten, Wetter gekommen zu gehen. Weil die Jiden in Eretz Israel
Stern Schnir alle Per alle Gilder ne von Ne Schiabel Dovid Sitz oben on Oi Halda Becher In der rechter Hand macht Abroche Auf dem ganzen Land Oi Oben Biomen Is do Savor Ne Schiach Vet Kunel Chain Six Nior Oi Oben Biomen Is do Savor Ne Schiach Vet Kunel Chain Six Nior Mashiach ben David sitzt oben on ei halda beher in der rechter Hand amal zerbroche ach im ganzen Land oi omen bei omen is do sabor Mashiach mit kumel chayn six yor oi omen bei omen is do sabor Mashiach mit kumel chayn six yor oi da 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 Mashiach ben David, sitzt oben on, oi schnirale, perle, dolderne von, Mashiach ben David, sitzt oben on. Und gesollet auf den Herzen, nacht men alle Chagi, oi berumet los nit ruhe, singen mir, Alit, siz nit ok in bissel drumpfen, lo mir trinken magim. Meim heim is doch heim, was darf noch ein? So schön kommen die Gehule, so schön kommen die Gehule. Schön kommen die Gehule, Moschiach komm schön bald. So schön kommen die Gehule, so schön kommen die Gehule, so schön kommen die Gehule, Moschiach komm schön bald. Za Dorf und Kulechaev, seid nicht Kinderonim, und von sindigen Mashiach, gicher kumen weg. Ach du Tatel in Himmel, zbeten bnei Rachmonim, ze Mashiach soll nicht kumen, a pisale zu spät. So schön kommen die Gehule, so schön kommen die Gehule, so schön kommen die Gehule, Moschiach komm schön bald. So schön kommen die Gehule, so schön kommen die Gehule, so schön kommen die Gehule, Moschiach komm schön bald. Beiner in die Wälde, Stern auf dem Himmel. Rettis Reul der Mechuten, dreht sich in der Miet. Svet sich hufeken Moschiach, sein tiefen Driemel, wenn Wetter Herrn unser hat viele dicke Lied. So schön kommen die Gehule, so schön kommen die Gehule, so schön kommen die Gehule, wo sie ja komm schön bald, so schön kommen die Gehule. Boris Kirchner.
Maria Krupovic.
We can. Thank you very much. Okay. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for inviting us. Thank you.
It took me back to Kaunas. It was just so moving.
Thank you so much. We couldn't leave this stage without singing the song of songs in the realm of love songs, that is Ich hab dich zu viel lieb. I love you so much that I cannot think about any revenge. Ich hab dich zu viel lieb, zu sein auf dir in Kass. Ich hab dich zu viel lieb, zu sein auf dir gorbest. Anna, ich heiß, ich weiß, ich hab dich lieb. Hab dir mein Leben habe gegeben, mein Herz und meine Schöne. Ich bin krank, nur mein Gedanke trag nicht von der Komme. Gegeben mein Herz und meine Schöne. Ich bin krank, nur mein Gedanke trag nicht von der Komme. Ich hab dich zu viel lieb, ich trage auf dir kein Hass. Ich hab dich zu viel lieb, zu sein auf dir in Hass. Ich hab dich zu viel lieb, zu sein auf dir gorbeis. Anna, ich weiß, ich hab dich lieb.
Thank you.
Thank you. What an amazing afternoon we've had. What a wonderful concert to finish with. Thank you so much. Thank you to all our wonderful speakers that have been with us this afternoon. Thank you to the embassy. Thank you to the ministry. Thank you to our tech and our helpers this afternoon, Tamara and Sarah. Please do stay around. The wine is about to appear when I open the door. And we have the books, both we have things to give to you and to sell to you. Ulla, did you want to say something?
I just want to say that we will be around. And so who is interested, we will elaborate more. But we have a book by Laimonas Briedis, who was a panelist today, and also some other books related to Lithuanian Jewish memory. So please ask. We are very happy to explain. Some things are to take away. Some things are to buy.
Those of you that want to come back, those of you really dedicated, I'm teaching on Tuesday morning as well, but that's a whole other thing.